Welcome everyone who's joining us here today for this live talk on Capital Insider series. We are very privileged to have with us today Mr. Sudhir Sethi, who's the founder and chairman of Chirate Ventures India. And of course, he's done brilliant work at Chirate Ventures in terms of building the fund, which has today become, I think I have some numbers here with me. And sir, please correct me if I'm wrong, but I think in the fourth fund that you raised, you've done about 90 investments in all, 2 IPOs, 35 exits, and 4 unicorns. That's a really, really envious number to have for a fund. Sure. And I was very privileged to have you here for this talk. But I think what I really like about Mr. Sethi's philosophy is that, he feels that the digital age has only just started. So we've only actually touched the tip of the iceberg when it comes to really exploring opportunities that Digital India is today going to give us. So Digital India's push to Startup India is today evident. And this is what we're going to talk about. While the pandemic has been extremely disruptive, we've been sitting in our homes, lockdowns, 6 months now. But I think if we'll go down and look at this pandemic in 2025, we'll probably also realize this was the most golden age and the most hitting moment for Digital India to really take up in its full glory. And the opportunity has just started. So welcome, Mr. Sudhir Sethi. And I would love to hear from you. What do you think today are the real opportunities that Digital India holds today? Given the fact there's so much as a country we need to develop, we also need to think a lot more intrinsic when it comes to platforms and technologies that we need. So really, from your lenses, what are the opportunities for Digital India and for startups building or finding themselves building technology businesses?
Ritu, thank you very much for inviting me here. It's a pleasure again. And I hope all of you and all the people watching are safe and sound. First, one small correction. We've invested in 90 companies and all the numbers you mentioned in all our funds, not just the fourth fund overall. I think it's important to look at the fact that India being digital is a phase which we are going through. The internet is a highway like the road infrastructure in India. I think it's also a bit patchy right now. But what the pandemic has done is, of course, taken anything and everything which you do in the physical world, wherever it is possible to do in the digital world, is now being preponed. Whether it is buying goods and services, whether it is B2B, whether it is B2C, whether it is fitness, whether it is health, whether it is the whole space of agriculture, finance, you name it, every part of our lives have been affected. And I think while there is stress in the economy, there is no doubt there is stress among people. If we look at this as a business opportunity, as an opportunity and a glass half full, you will notice that there are many, many green shoots which have already emerged in the market space. There are challenges which the country faces, and there are a billion plus people who don't have healthcare. How do you reach a billion plus people, and how do you deliver healthcare in this day and age where we have not been able to deliver the number of doctors, we don't have the number of nurses, we don't have the number of clinics, the number of CT scans. I mean, the list goes on and on. So the conventional method of delivering healthcare to a billion people, I think will not help at all. So the question is, how can you use the digital platform to deliver basic health at least first? I can understand that emergency and health related to expertise which is required in surgery or cancer, or that's a physical process, but there is no reason why basic health cannot be delivered. Okay, basic health, if you deliver it in the conventional way, we'll need another 300,000-400,000 doctors, but today it's possible to reach somebody in Trivandrum or in Siliguri digitally and give that health care services from experts anywhere in the world, okay, not just India. And the, is it possible to set up clinics? Is it possible to set up pathology labs in the country, which follow the conventional method? So effectively, there are easier and more technology advanced ways by which you can, we can deliver to a billion people health. The same applies to education. The same applies to SMEs who need capital for working capital. The same applies to farmers. There are hundreds of millions of farmers in the country who are struggling even today on average 2.5 acres worth of land which they own, and crop productivity is still a big issue. Okay, so I think if you look at it from that point of view, the digital infrastructure of the company, wherever it is on a scale of 10, can move us into a very different, a much, much larger scaled direction while it sits on top of the infrastructure which is already there. And that's where the power of digital lies, to solve problems which have not been solved before using technology and reach masses, whether it is in consumers or farmers or businesses, okay, in a much more efficient manner and deliver results.
Sure. And what particular sectors you particularly see? And of course, you know, I mean, given the fact that we're also seeing, you know, the rift between Google and a lot of technology companies on the Play Store, what areas do you feel we need to build our technologies in order to be more self-sufficient as a country? And we don't really all the time have to rely on, international companies to help us or to enable us to reach out to our customers. What more we could doing, and in what sectors we should be doing that?
I think the answer to what sectors is every sector. I mean, look at it. The sectors which I named, every sector needs to scale up. E-commerce companies, when we invested in Myntra, you know, the number of active consumers who were buying and selling on the product on the net was 10 million. Today is maybe 100, 120 million. We are talking about 500 million, 600, 700 million people in the near future coming on the internet and transacting commerce, right? In whichever way, whether it is services or products. I think those efficiencies have to come in. Supply chain, okay? It's in every sector. Supply chain from, you know, large companies to kirana stores. It is very inefficient. It goes through distributors and there is margin loss there. There is inefficiency. There is delays in delivery. So I think there's enough work to be done where digital infrastructure can play a very large role by building marketplaces, by building technology platforms which enable see-through for large companies to go to the smaller retailers. Wherever retailers are not required, at the end of the day, consumers can be reached directly. I think that's another platform. So as I said, every sector, there is nothing called it can't, digital infrastructure, digital India cannot reach that. It can.
While this is one side where you say that every sector needs more technology and more technology disruption to make it more efficient. Given the fact that Make in India is the order of the day, particularly for digital businesses, so how can Indian startup founders, what will be your advice to them to say that, you know, you can build products which are more efficient, which have a great user experience? And, you know, at the end of the day, if an Indian customer feels that I'm much better off with an international technology, how can he reduce that conflict? This is one thing that I have been witnessing a lot wherein, you know, we read apps, we read reviews, and we feel that this is something which is a backlash which is coming in today for a lot of Indian startup founders when their technologies are compared to the rest of the world. So what can they do to make their product better, more at par with the rest of the world? And of course, now considering the fact that it's already been done outside and there is already an existing product outside, and therefore you have to sort of now do it in a much faster time to be able to reach out to your customer. So what would be your advice to them?
I think it's very simple. You're assuming it's not being done already. So I think that's, maybe if I can correct that. In our active companies, we have 55 active companies. We've exited the rest. 24 of our companies have a global footprint. That means entrepreneurs have developed products which are relevant, valid, and comparable to the best in the world, and perhaps leaders. Okay, there is no question about it. So Indian entrepreneurs in the space of technology, whether it is in mobility, whether it is in AR, VR, whether it is in robotics, are building global companies. And the reason why they are building global companies is because fundamentally the nature of the young entrepreneur is a global mindset. The internet has given them access. And to that extent, software companies, you know, previously built global companies. Today, Indian entrepreneurs and products are going to build global companies. We've seen that already. Sure. And in a small way, that will happen more and more again. So I think I would disagree that Indian consumers are looking for international products. I mean, anywhere in the world, people look for the best brand and the best products, right? In today, Lenskart is selling in the US. Today, First Cry is selling in the Middle East. Today, a small company called Emotix, which has designed a consumer robotic companion robot for children, is selling in 40 countries. Today, a company like PlaySifu is selling AR, VR, educational toys on the global roadmap. So I think today you will find that if you're solving a challenge which Indians are facing, trust me, that challenge is being faced somewhere in the world.
Correct.
The mind of the entrepreneur is, if you compare it to, India's an open market, so anybody can come in. And the way the entrepreneur thinks is, if anybody can come in, why shouldn't I go out? Because that's, offense is the best way of defense. So we are finding young companies going international, right? Today there's a company called, in our portfolio, called Aether. And they have built one of the world's leading upper arm prosthetics, which is a bionic arm. No other company in the world has that. We are talking about KB Colors, which is extracting color out of microbes, okay, by applying stress. No other company in the world has that. And the list goes on and on. We're talking about Cropin, who's managing 7 million acres of land through satellite imagery, okay, and influencing crop productivity. And this is in India and outside the country. So I think this myth about Indian products and services in the technology space not being up to the mark in the global sense is not true, because half our companies are already selling outside the country in 40 countries, right? Will this increase now? Answer is yes. This will increase because when Indian products are developed, they are developed at a price point which Indians want. They are developed at a quality which Indians and the globe want. The price points are attractive and the quality has to be the best. And that's a potent combination for building a global company.
Totally agree, Mr. Sethi, on this. But where I was coming from more was that, you know, about 5 years back when a new startup used to happen, it used to be the only one doing what it was doing. But today the competition is catching up very fast because, of course, there is a lot of opportunity. And there is, you know, the capital is only going to be so much. And, you know, while the funds would want to put it across all startups and see all of them rising, but, you know, eventually the best will have to win. So how can we ensure that everybody in this ecosystem is able to sort of succeed instead of just some few because of the lack of funding? How can the environment be much more collaborative? While competition is good and it always helps everybody to, I mean, the best to grow and consumers to use the best. But nevertheless, you know, the others are also building technologies which are fairly good. So how, I mean, at the end of the day, how can less startups fail? That is most important.
That is not the goal, Ritu. The right question is, are companies being built? Are differentiating technologies being built? Are products being built? I mean, today, just again, I can only take Proxy, which is us right now. In our portfolio, 120 patents have been filed, 28 have been granted in US and India. That is an indication. You know, early stage venture capital is a proxy for R&D capital, okay? And the innovation which is being done today, by the way, can it be better? Answer is yes. But let's be very clear that at the end of the day, I don't think government can come in and say, let's do things better and this is how. There is no recipe and prescription here, right? Intense competition is the only way to build better products and better services. Yeah. And I think we have that already. And Indian entrepreneurs in a small way have delivered. I think the scale at which we have to deliver is much larger. We are seeing that. In fact, the last 5 years, if the gradient of companies growing successfully has been 20 degrees in the last 5 years, the next 5 years, I see that as something closer to 45 degrees. There is an inflection point which is already reached in the market space where companies are growing larger and larger. And I do not agree that capital in India is not there. Capital in India is there. It's there at seed stage. It's there at early stage. It's there at maybe small gaps and B rounds or so. But it's definitely there after that in late stage. In fact, post-COVID, we have seen more companies in our portfolio getting late stage funding and B rounds upwards of funding. We've seen more capital come in because the quality of the entrepreneur and the product and the service and the revenue model and the business model and the technology, and by the way, it's not or, it's and situation, has even further differentiated and put some companies, not all of them, to a higher pedestal. And capital chases the best in quality.
Yeah, but where I was coming from was the data says that only about 8% of startups in India are funded. So there's a huge scope for more funding, but important is that the startups should not be copycats of each other. They need to be doing different work. They need to be solving a different problem in order to maximize.
Ritu, there is a space under the roof for exceptional, disruptive, global quality startups. There is a place to deliver copycats. There is, you know, it's the VC, by the way, is not the end of the world. There are enough capital which fund boutique companies, right? Why does a small boutique survive? Because it is meant to be small. And by the way, it's a profitable venture. I think yes. We have to change the definition that venture capital is the end of it all. Okay. At the end of the day, there are tens of millions of entrepreneurs who run Kirana stores in the country. And by the way, they were the backbone of the country when the pandemic happened, where the large e-commerce players could not deliver. Right.
Right.
100% backbone for 6 months. That is an amazing story to say. So all I'm coming back and saying, we know what's not there, but I am very positive that the gradient is shooting up right now. And there's enough venture capital, which builds global companies and domestic leaders in the market space. The digital push has enhanced the tailwind. There is a big tailwind, which is coming in right now, which is already seeing companies. And we are noticing that we are seeing more than half of our companies growing faster than they used to pre-COVID. And this has been only 6-7 months. And I'll give you a very simple example in our own portfolio, because I know that the total revenue of all our companies put together in the month of March was approximately $1 billion.
Hmm.
In the month of April, it went to 350 million.
Wow.
In the month of May, it went back to 650 million. And today we are almost back to a billion. So a lot of economists are talking about, you know, whether the recovery is going to be U-shaped, V-shaped, W-shaped, and any shape you can think of. But here is a classic example at an aggregate level. There are some companies who are not doing well, but many are doing well. Okay. Where the companies who, the reason why this aggregate $1 billion to $1 billion in our portfolio has happened in terms of revenue is because they followed fundamentally agility, enormous innovation, digital, online, and many of them have gone global again, much, much faster. Lenskart went global post-COVID into US. They were already in Singapore. So I think entrepreneurs have adapted, preponed products. They've hired more people in technology. And many of them have filed more patents in this space. The entrepreneur is a very unique person, and this is a great time for them to thrive because they know how to go digital, they know how to go online, and India has provided that tailwind with in the last 6 months. Now, can they get more capital? Capital is available. In fact, in spite of China funds not being there, I don't think in the early stage there was Chinese funds anyway.
Okay. Yeah.
So that capital is still there. In fact, if you see the numbers, it's gone up.
Totally. Yeah. I mean, yeah, even in the pandemic and lockdowns, we've seen funding happening. So which is, I mean, something to be said about, you know, how digital businesses can still manage to grow at a time when lots of other businesses, non-digital businesses are unable to do it. So, you know, I mean,
today, if I may add one thing, digital business traditionally is thought of as consumer. We must think of digital also between B2B. We must think of marketplaces. We must think of efficiencies in supply chain, distribution chain, and what I think the government has done in removing some regulatory issues to facilitate, for instance, the farm to consumer, where the FPOs are going away and so on. That's a massive regulatory change, right?
Yeah.
Enables middlemen to go away. the fact that education, you know, education is a situation which is ripe for digital. Okay, it's an opportunity. In fact, I would even go to the extent of, you know, suggesting to the government, state levels and central levels, do not force people to come to schools. It's an opportunity, right? You can never build enough schools in the country to educate the people who don't have access. The manner in which, if you leave it optional, like many countries are doing, you'll find that schools will become available for children who need to go. The real challenge is the digital divide. Education today is ripe for growth and already growing because it's digital. So remove the regulatory framework. Okay, can there be a digital school? Why does
a school have been happening for such a long time?
Precisely. So can we have a digital school? Like we can have a digital market, can we have a digital school? Can we have digital universities? Can we have digital banks? Right? Why does a bank have to open up a branch? There is no need for a bank to open a branch. You will find that the digital push goes extremely better for people who can do this. And it will reach, you know, today the thinking like yesterday has been, to reach Siliguri, I need a branch. You don't. Because there are 10 people in Siliguri who can do digital stuff. They will be the role model for another 1,000. And those 1,000 will become role model for the whole of Siliguri. And to that extent, you don't need branches. It's time to change in a revolutionary manner rather than evolutionary manner. And regulation must lead that effort. Regulation cannot come back and say, you still need to put up branches. You still need to put up schools.
But I think it's probably, even for the government or even for the institution, it still is that reaching out to the last mile customer who may not be literate enough to still be able to take digital services. I think that is the bigger challenge. But as you said, that the middle person today needs to be educated enough to get him into or her into the system of digitization so that they're able to. The typical example is the middleman in the agricultural system, wherein the middleman himself can be the benefactor of digitization and lead the farmer on. Otherwise, there's going to be a big conflict between the middleman, the farmer, the government, the buying bodies. So it's eventually just like in education, it was the teacher whose comfort was important for digitization to happen. Here, the farmer's comfort is very important for digitization eventually become 100%.
Yeah, I think what's very important is for regulation not to protect anybody. Okay? It is important to note that if in the whole chain of supply or distribution, if any element is not adding value, that element, the system should permit it to go away. And system should permit it to bypass. There's no reason to protect a distributor just because he's a distributor in the yesterday years. There's no reason to protect a farm produce organization just because they were there yesterday, right? If the farmer has the capability to sell through a marketplace at the best price to 4 consumers and 10 businesses, so be it. That is the only way where people and organizations will be forced to prove that they're valuable into the system, right?
I think we've just lost Mr. Sethi for a minute there, as the system seems to be hung. But I do see there are some more questions also coming from our audience. We'll probably like to have Ankit George to be given the mic so that he can ask his question once Mr. Sethi comes back on live. Ankit, we'll just wait for a minute before we give it, because Mr. Sethi, we seem to have lost the connection with Mr. Sethi for a minute.
Sure thing.
Please keep your questions coming so that we can, once Mr. Sethi is back online, we can probably take all the questions at this point of time. So if the audience both I would like to ask some questions from Mr. Sethi, kindly post your questions now, ask them now so that we can take them up. Well, We've been in an interesting debate where Mr. Sethi has more or less told us that, you know, today what is important is that the person who is not able to take digitization or they are not able to understand how technology could be useful for them needs to get out of the system. I think that's a big statement. And I think, but perhaps the only way forward for the country to grow as we go digital. He's back with us. So Mr. Sethi, we've actually now got a lot of questions also coming for you. So we've got Ankit who wants to ask you a question. He's online. Ankit, go ahead, please.
Hi, thank you for the opportunity to ask my question. I just wanted to understand, so the ASEAN region is somewhat similar to India in terms of GDP per capita. It's not necessarily one single market because there are many sovereign countries and the like, unlike India with, you know, one country over a billion people. Just wanted to understand your view on the evolution and the future trajectory of digital India versus, say, a digital ASEAN region.
So I think the extent of digitization, especially in the consumer side of it in the ASEAN region, is obviously higher in terms of how much people spend time per day. In countries, in some countries, you know, screen time is as high as 8 hours a day overall, and India does not have that. I think the scale of opportunity which India presents in a shorter time frame is far, far higher than ASEAN, for the simple reason that the just the number of consumers and the number of businesses is far higher overall. But I do believe that the interface between cross-border commerce, whether it is, especially in B2B, is actually very high between ASEAN and India, and especially of products, technology products going into the market. We ourselves have a few companies who are growing into that market space apart from the US. So ASEAN in consumer is ahead of India right now. There's no question. In the digital infrastructure, it is ahead. India is behind. India needs to catch up very, very fast. But in scale, it will take over very fast.
Sure. I think that's really favorable for India, particularly given the fact that, you know, the whole region is so large. We also got Amandeep Srivastava who wants to ask a question. If we can just give him the mic, please go ahead. Unmute yourself, Aman, and ask the question. Unmute. Go ahead, please.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Very good evening, sir. So as I have heard that now the CV has invited the applications for the new cohort, may I know what kind of startups you're looking at? Because we are an IoT and AI based company developing smart devices for in B2B segment for various companies. So may I please know that what kind of companies you're looking at this time now?
We are talking about our innovation program, which we launched yesterday.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Oh, we are looking at innovative companies in technology in all sectors, whether it is agri-tech, fintech, you know, any sector which you want to name. And there's no definition of we're looking at only these technologies. We have invested in a wide range of technologies, and we believe that newer technologies will come in and older technologies will mature. So there is no limitation and restriction.
And at what kind of stage, sir? Actually, sir, last year we were thinking to participate in that, but we were at a very early stage. But now we have some MVP. So can we go for it now?
Yes, of course you can go for it. Just apply. We're looking at seed companies. We're looking at Series A companies. It's a combination.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Amandeep. You know, while Amandeep has asked, and I was about to ask you the same question about the innovators program. So, you know, how do you think the innovators program that you've, you know, or you, I think this is the fifth edition that you are doing for the innovators program. And as a fund, Chirate is actually investing in the early stage startup companies also, and also goes on right to Series A, Series B funding. So with this broad spectrum and also inviting a lot of young entrepreneurs like Amandeep to be part of the innovators program. So how is it that you see that, you know, that you have the right balanced set of companies in the portfolio and they're able to therefore maximize being part of Chirate, and you're also able to see a big growth at Chirate with these companies?
So Ritu, number one, it's the seventh cohort. It's the longest running innovation program in the country. You know, if you look at our fund, we've invested in 90 companies, and seed early stage seed companies have been 50. And these seed companies have collectively raised $500 million in capital, and they're valued over $1 billion right now. So I think our methodology in the market is to identify and work with entrepreneurs very, very early. This is a 5-week program. We'll work with the entrepreneurs. We'll look at go-to-market. We'll look at advice. We'll look at collecting two entrepreneurs together. We've got Mukesh Bansal of Myntra coming in. Sorry, Mukesh Bansal of CureFit, who will also spend some time. We've got Supam from FirstCry coming in, and you know, other entrepreneurs who have confirmed that, look, in our portfolio, they'll spend some time guiding some of the younger entrepreneurs and into product, into go-to-market, into business, into anything which is there. So for us, it's not an imbalance. It is a strategy by design to engage with entrepreneurs very early, because that's where value is built, right at the early stage, identifying companies which are solving real problems using technology which have not been solved before.
Surely. And I mean, you know, there is somebody who's asking, Anirban, who's saying that, do you feel that content creation, especially in sports for the digital audience, stands as a big opportunity? I mean, now they're getting more particular about, you know, what could be an opportunity today. But I mean, given the fact, you know, that IPL ran its course today in a different country where there was less pandemic situation, and given the fact that fantasy gaming and different kind of gaming opportunities have seen such an uproar during this time, I mean, his question might just be too relevant that, you know, do you think we need more digital content around sports in the online space?
Well, first and foremost, I'm disappointed IPL is being held outside the country. If with those precautions, IPL could be held in Dubai, it could be held in India also. But that's a different story. Look, at the end of the day, IPL being played is already digital, and that throws up enormous amount of opportunities in gaming, in sports. Will it happen? Yes, it will happen. Will it happen slowly or fast? I don't know the answer to that. But certainly, the whole gaming space, I mean, there are already companies. We have a company called PlaySimple right now doing extremely well in gaming in the market space. So will gaming scale in India? I think it will. Will esports scale in India? It will. Will people spend 8 hours a day like they do perhaps in Philippines or other countries? The answer is no. I think Indian habits on data consumption and on gaming are not going to be as high as that. I think they will be lower because there's so much other things to do in the market space, right from education to buying products online to, you know, but screen time is increasing. Let's be clear. Screen time for especially kids, teenagers is shooting up right now. So that's a market which will develop. I hope it doesn't go to 8 hours a day because that's a waste of time.
That would be a bit too much for the eyes also. Then we need startups to fix the eyes.
Okay.
So, this is one thing that I've been thinking about for some time, that, you know, while the pandemic has sort of got e-commerce and, you know, the various streams of e-commerce out there, whether it was social commerce or whether it was, fixing your hyper-local commerce, that sort of saw a big upsurge during this time. But per se, e-commerce did not attract a lot of funding as much as, you know, supply chain and logistic companies did, particularly during the pandemic. So do you feel the next step for e-commerce companies, or probably even for D2C startups, is to go the IPO route? And do you think, particularly for, you mentioned about Lenskart, FirstCry, do you think now the next big, growth for them for raising capital that they need to go overseas and to different markets might come from doing an IPO? And should they be doing this in India or outside India?
So you asked me three questions. One is not enough funding came into e-commerce and people went into supply chain. Well, yes. Venture capital goes where there's a problem to fix. Okay. Right. And that becomes an opportunity. So, so that is fine. There's no problem at all. The e-commerce companies, you know, took some time to set their house in order and deliver. Today, they're doing very well, by the way, right? Yes. Now, which means fundamentally, there are two broad kinds of e-commerce companies in the market space. One is horizontals, which are basically two in the country, which is Amazon and Flipkart. And hopefully geo emerging overall. I think India is large enough to accommodate three, and I heard some news about the Tata also consolidating. So India is large enough to have three or four, at least in the next 5 years. So that's a great, that's to me is a great thing to happen for the country. Second thing is, there is the whole e-commerce market of verticals. And you mentioned Lenskart and First Try. You know, verticals are high margin businesses. Verticals, after a certain time, and people like Lenskart, First Try, CureFit are verticals in nature. You know, one in health and the other two in, one in eyewear, the other in baby care. I think the opportunity for verticals, like in the horizontals, is actually very high. And the reason for that is very simple. The verticals have dominated the market right now. And because they're high margin businesses, they require less capital. And to that extent, verticals can grow internationally much faster. Why? Because those kind of verticals, by the way, in surrounding countries and maybe in some of the large developed countries do not exist. I mean, today, eyewear in volumes, Lenskart is the second largest in the world, right? And please understand, when such products go outside the country, they make more money, the margins are higher. When an international company comes into the country, the margins are lower. Overall,
correct.
I think for e-commerce verticals, it's time to now scale the brand, scale private label, scale manufacturing in India. Okay, because there's a big opportunity to scale manufacturing in India. Because the moment you do private label, you have to back-end integrate to manufacturing, build the logistics, introduce robotics into warehousing, and you know there's a lot of stuff to be done. Yeah. And become some of them become global companies. Now, by the way, this can be funded by private capital, and some of the large companies could go public. Public is a means to get capital into the system and also provide exits to some of the investors. Will some companies go public? I think the answer is yes. And let me give you some statistics. If you look at the number of companies which are funded, private technology companies, which are above 100 million valuation, they're about 140, 150 in the country, right? In the next 10 years, to me, another 50, 60 companies will go public. So why? Because they're large enough to go public and they want to remain independent. Okay. The end of life of a company is not to sell. These companies want to go public because they want to build larger institutions over a period of time and they want to continue to be running for the next 20, 25 years. Okay. That's the reason why they go public. And that market, I think, is emerging right now.
So I mean, e-commerce clearly is one place we're looking at. Where else do you see IPOs happening?
No, I mean, companies for new look at e-commerce. Surrounding e-commerce is delivery. So some of the delivery companies could go public in the market space. Some of the health companies could go public in the market space were large enough. So I don't, it's a sector issue. I think, you know, we have a very large company in education, Byju's. Now, it all depends on their board and what they want to do. But is it ripe? Is it scaled enough for an IPO? The answer is yes. And I do hope they go public.
Sure, absolutely. So this is, so IPOs probably for startups is something we have not seen so much. So far, but you know, would
you'll
love
see
to see.
I think you'll see more. You'll see definitely more.
Yes. So there's Aditya Gule who's asking, what do you think is the future of educational content marketplaces in India post COVID?
Educational content is in for a revolution because traditional education content has been, you know, subscribed to books prescribed by somebody and so on and so forth. But I think education content, which is one is prescription based, which is subscribed by courses, and the other one is, you know, non-prescription based. I think both are in for a big revolution because the consumption patterns of education content will become very different, especially if regulations allow the option of online education. You'll find content has to be delivered in a very different and much more efficient manner. It can't be delivered in, you know, you can't take a book online and say this is online. It has to be different content. It has to be consumed in a different way. It has to have perhaps gaming inscribed into it. So I think there is enough technology intervention where education can be much more effective and especially content can be much more effective in the market space.
Sure. You know, we're coming almost to the end of the time, but you know, finally, we'd love to know from you, Mr. Sethi, what is your advice to startups who are today in very early stages of building a startup, and they're obviously facing some kind of, you know, and you cannot travel, they cannot go out show and their products to the neither the venture capitalist nor the customer, everything has to be done on the screen. So obviously, you know, and they're young on top of it, you know, they still don't have the years of experience to run through it. So what is your advice to them? You know, three pieces of advice that you can give to them to stay strong and to build the companies that they really want to.
Number one, don't give up. I think this is a good time, and so will be in the future. Number two, I think the digital opportunity in content, in communications, in delivery of products and services, both in B2B and B2C. Many of our companies are today correcting their SOPs on how to get new business where salespeople were required earlier. So I think every challenge or every process which was there in building a company needs to be reviewed pre-COVID to post-COVID and see where digital intervention can take place. You know, where you have to hire salespeople, can you technology help? Where you have to CureFit enhanced pre-poned its at-home fitness products by 6 months. And that's done very well. They're now testing the product in the US overall. So I think the opportunity is very high. Just make sure, A, don't give up. Second, fine-tune the product and the service to a digital consumer and a digital consumption society. Do look at options, but also raise capital early. There is nothing but a good company will get funded today. Whether it is through angels, whether it is through VCs like us, there is enough capital in the market. Go to families in the industrial families in the country. They are looking for good opportunities to invest in. Okay. And there are platforms available to do that. So I think this is a great time, but make sure you have adequate, if not a little bit more capital than what you think. Okay. Don't worry about valuation beyond a point, because if you have capital, you can grow.
Sure. Thank you very much. That's very helpful, Mr. Sethi. And, you know, the next time, hopefully, I said this last time too, but hopefully next time we meet in person and not on in the screen, because, you know, I think everybody now, 6 months down the line, we've all missed meeting each other and the great ideas. And I think we've all sort of refreshed ourselves in certain ways when we have stayed at home and thought about our businesses. While some procrastination there, but at the end of the day, some great ideas also coming out and new businesses looking to grow. So thank you for joining us, Mr. Sethi, today. And also thank you very much for the audience who joined us here today for this talk. If you have more questions for Mr. Sethi or for Chidate Ventures, please keep on posting it at the link of the Facebook Live so that we can ask somebody at Chidate to answer these questions for you. And hopefully next time we meet in person and not in front of a screen as we get and down to building more businesses in digital India. Thank you once again, Mr.
Thank you very much, Ritu, and all the best. And thank you to everybody. Bye-bye.
Thank you.